Okay, in accordance with the Open Public Meetings Act, PL 1975, Chapter 231, adequate notice of this regular meeting of the Board of Adjustment of the Township of Franklin has been provided. Call the roll, please.
Mr. Betterbid. Ms. Grauman.
Here.
Mr. Johnson.
Here.
Mr. McCracken. Mr. Rich.
Here.
Mr. Shepherd.
Here.
Mr. Caldwell. Mr. Rosenthal. Mr. Reese. Ms. Pagallo.
Here.
Chairman Thomas.
Here. Minutes of the regular meeting, October 6, 2016. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Mr. Johnson.
Yes.
Mr. Rich.
Yes.
Chairman Thomas.
Yes. Vouchers. Or clean energy.
Are we going to do these individually or?
I'll just read them and we'll do them together on that, just so it's public. U.S. Clean Energy, $210. Potosnik and Pike, $157. Ali, $210. Shen, $140. Somerset Fitness, $140. Regency Heritage Nursing, $385. Fiorino, $175. Iglesia Cristiana del Vivo, $280. Star Bazaar, $122.50. These are resolutions for vouchers for Mr. Bradshaw. Is there?
Move it.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed. First hearing on the agenda, Keith Wilson, ZBA 15-00041, variance in which the applicant's requesting to use a portion of his home as a chiropractic office at 22 Nina Court, Somerset, Block 83, Lot 17.22 in the R20 zone.
Yeah. Yeah, these are the microphone.
Do we need the preface?
Yeah.
We have five people. We want to do the hearing. We're expecting more people.
You get the gravity of the use variance. You need five yeses. So I guess you can decide whether or not you want them to vote if you just want to put your presentation on and then kind of see where it's going for you. And you can make that decision at that time if you want, or not proceed at all if you want to wait for a full board.
We could present and see how the vote goes.
Speaking to the mic. I mean that's obviously up to the board as well, but usually that works. And then, you know, if you don't take a vote tonight, another missing member can either watch the video or.
Well, there could be a discussion after your presentation, and you would get a sense of where the wind was blowing.
Yes, understood. Thank you. Okay, so let's, since we're here,
all right,
feeling like we can proceed.
You want me to swear in your witness now, or are you going to give us a prologue? Or?
Just a brief description of, this is an application by Dr. Keith Wilson, whose office is presently adjacent to the Stagehouse restaurant. Dr. Wilson's wife has a number of very serious medical issues, including cancer, vertigo, pancreatic tumor, and multiple sclerosis. And Dr. Wilson has found even being a half mile or a mile away from home has created, is a difficulty based upon his wife's condition. And he's also basically winding down his practice. So we're applying to the board this evening for permission to have a use variance so that he can see approximately six patients per day, 4 days a week, at his residence at 22 Nina Court. I misspoke. With that, I'm prepared to continue with Dr. Wilson.
Okay. First, just for the record, your name?
I'm sorry.
I know.
B. Shammy Jr. on behalf of Dr. Keith Wilson.
Okay. Mr. Shammy, can you grab that other microphone so we can have your client speaking to that.
Here he comes.
I told you Bob's
going to be
here.
Show that's
Bob never misses
appearing to be. Mr. Shepherd has arrived at 7:40.
Okay, Dr. Wilson, if you raise your right hand for me, do you solemnly swear or affirm to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
I do.
Okay, and using the microphone, make sure it's on, give it a tap at the top.
Hello?
Okay, just tell us who you are for the record.
Dr. Keith Wilson, lived at 22 Nina Court for the last 30 years. And Ed just read what it's about, my wife. Unfortunately, I used to have a practice in Parlin, and she ended up getting breast cancer. We went through breast cancer with her, and I had four little kids at the time, and I had to sell my practice over there to move closer. So 15 years ago, I moved over to the Stage House, which has been very good for me. But in the last 3 years, my wife's fallen three times and broke a leg, femur. She has a stability rod in her leg, right leg. She's broken her hand, her wrist. She suffers from a vertigo. She has osteoporosis under the care of Dr. Nissenblatt, who's our oncologist. And she has MS, which makes it doubly worse. She pretty much stays in the house most of the time unless I'm home and I can take her out, but her sisters are going over there several hours, a couple hours a day, blah, blah, blah. And I feel like that's really been an impingement on their life. I just feel like, you know, I get seven calls a day in the morning from her because I have to check on her constantly. And I just can't keep doing this. So I have a very good practice right by Stage House. I'm a third of a mile away from home, and it's a third of a mile too far. I feel like I have to be there. I'd make all the meals. She can't anything. I clean the house. I pretty much do everything, and it sounds like, you know, I'm trying to pat myself on the back, but I'm not. It's just the way it is. My kids are all out of state. They're all doing very well, but they're not home. And she feels like she needs me home. So I'm giving up basically my practice, and I just want to keep my mind sharp and practice, maybe see six people a day. And I'll be no sign. I don't want a sign. I'm not even in the telephone book next year. I didn't renew it with them. If it winds down and people leave, I won't be advertising for more. And that's just the way it is. And
what about parking?
I have just did my whole driveway over.
And there would be room for
room. Yeah, I'm going to see one person maybe every 30 minutes and see six people a day.
So it sounds like then, because you had indicated up to maximum of six per day, you won't have keep people waiting. So it sounds like at most you'd have one patient car. Maybe when one is going and one is coming, one is going. Maybe you have two. Maybe.
If
that's switchover. But other than that, that's going to be the maximum amount of traffic at any point.
That's
and they're going to park in your driveway.
Mm-hmm.
And you'd indicated no sign.
No sign.
And then staff had recommended that since, you know, a lot of your testimony was just about your particular situation, that if the board was to approve it, that it would cease upon the termination of your practice.
Absolutely.
It wouldn't run with the land. You
no.
wouldn't be able to sell it as a medical
Just
office.
Just sell it as a house.
You know,
that's it.
Next.
Nope.
Exactly. Okay.
Don't need any of that.
So
well, that's an interesting question. I'd like to ask our attorney if we can do that.
Yes, you can do that. You still have to meet the other proofs in your mind when you make the vote. But, yes, you can have that condition.
And, Doctor, from your driveway, the access to the for the patients would be in the back of your home?
Yes.
Okay.
There's a new paved pavers all the way around to the door. And there's no steps.
There's no steps. So it would be handicapped accessible
yep.
if you had any patients that, you know,
yep.
required the use of a wheelchair or something like
yes.
that. That could work.
Yep.
Okay. And you also, is there a restroom adjacent to the
yes.
patient area?
Right next to it.
Okay. And that's also set up for a handicapped individual?
Yep. My wife uses it.
Okay. And the condition that was just described, I think you indicated you would have no problem with the variance ceasing upon termination.
Absolutely none.
Okay.
You said 4 days a week, is that what you said?
Yeah, and it won't be all day.
No weekends?
I over here, I've dropped my practice down to six days a week. I work Mondays in the morning from 8 o'clock until 11, and then I work from 2:30 in the afternoon till 6. And it'll probably be almost the same at the house. So, and then Tuesdays, I only work in the morning. Thursdays, I only work in the morning.
And which was the fourth day?
The fourth day would be Wednesday, same as Monday.
Okay. So Tuesday, Thursday, shorter days?
Yes. Yep.
And there's no hours on Friday, Saturday,
or
Sunday, correct?
No weekend hours at all. That's what
and
I
again,
do. Most
for
of
the
them
record,
cooking.
I think there's no out. If you were to drive by the house, there would be no outward change visible to anybody other than what was there before.
Is that correct, Doctor?
Yeah.
Wouldn't know it's the doctor's office.
Yeah, there'd be no change.
So there's no impact visually on the zone plan or the neighborhood?
No, you wouldn't know even there.
Just out of curiosity, have you discussed it with your neighbors?
I have.
And
they're all in favor of it. Nobody said anything. They just said, good for you. They know the condition of my wife, so they, you know.
Are any of your neighbors here tonight?
I have no idea. I don't see anybody here at my direct neighbor. But I can tell you on my cul-de-sac and the one behind it, there's nobody.
Does anybody need any more information? We'll open to the public. Does anyone want to make a statement or ask a question concerning the application? Then we'll close. Does anybody need anything more for this?
No.
No. I'll go ahead and call for a motion instead of a summary.
I move approval of this subject to the hours that the applicant described, days and hours, and conditioned upon this this home office use being limited to his own use and is to cease upon either the close of his business or the sale of his home. It will not be part of the rights of the property.
Second?
Second.
Anyone have anything? Okay, poll the board.
Ms. Graman?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Rich?
Yes.
Mr. Shepherd?
Yes.
Ms. Bergala?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson? Oh, I called you already, sorry. Yes. Chairman Thomas?
Yes. Good luck with it.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank
you, ladies. Okay. New York SMSA Limited, doing business as Verizon Wireless, ZBA 16-00033. Site plan, which the applicant's looking to place 118-foot telecommunications tower at 156 Cedar Grove Lane, Somerset, block 424.12, lot 5.01 in the R40 zone. I think we're up to six members.
Yes. You're going to need the mic every time, and you may want to grab the other one too, just so you.
Yeah, I'll have my witnesses grab that. Richard Stanzione. Township, New Jersey, representing the applicant. Yeah, I understand you have six members prepared to proceed this evening.
Okay, you're on.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As you indicated, our proposal here is to put up a wireless telecommunications facility, which we intend to stealth as what we call a monopine, a design to blend into the surrounding neighborhood. On the swim club property, at 156 Cedar Grove Lane. I have three witnesses with me this evening, Mr. Chad Schwartz, my site engineer, Mr. Sean Heinberg, my radio frequency engineer, and lastly, Mr. Rick Masters, my planner. If we may, we could have Mr. Schwartz sworn. I'll give him this microphone. I'll take the other one.
Okay, if you raise your right hand for me, do you solemnly swear or affirm to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
I do.
State your name for the record, spelling it for me.
Chad Schwartz, S-C-H-W-A-R-T-Z.
All right.
Can we just ask you, can you set that up over there and angle it kind of sideways so that the public and the board can see?
Well, so that we can see through us.
Usually they just...
Yeah, better.
Keep going, Chad. A little bit further back. There you go, buddy.
All right. Good.
Good.
All right.
It's like when you're backing up off the cliff and they
right,
move
right.
back.
Put my faith in you there.
Yeah. Okay. Mr. Schwartz, for the benefit of the board and for the public, could you give me your educational background, your work experience, and the capacity in which you're appearing here this evening?
Sure. So I'm a licensed professional engineer in the state of New Jersey. I have a degree in engineering from Rutgers University. I've been working in the wireless industry for coming up on 17 years now. That's pretty much the only thing I've done in my professional life. Currently, Malik and Scherer, which is who the plans were created under, has the wireless department has morphed into Scherer Design Group, same company, same offices, and I am presently
we'll
the...
accept
the
Thank you. Now, Mr. Schwartz, would you give a brief overview of the property, its location, and the existing conditions on the property?
Sure. We're looking at, presently looking at the zoning drawings, preliminary and final site plans for the latest revision date is updated per area of disturbance, dated 6/24/16, drawing sheet Z4. The reference property is known by Verizon as a site named Quailbrook, and the street address is 156 Cedar Grove Lane, Somerset, New Jersey. What we're looking at, this is the property, has a swim club on it. So there's a, essentially, as you come in the driveway, there's a large parking lot, which, you know, proceeds back through a narrower lane to another parking lot, several existing buildings back there for maintenance, recreation, and other things. There's pools, tennis courts, and so on and so forth. In the southernmost corner of the property, it's essentially a wooded area. And there's a narrow driveway that heads back through there. And basically, at the end of that driveway is where we're proposing our facility. The location was chosen based upon the configuration of the property to allow beneficial use of the remainder of the property, while the location for the cell site was chosen to maximize the distance from all the surrounding residences. We've sort of optimized it, you know, in that corner, and to the greatest extent possible met the setback requirements.
All right. Well, let's talk about that. Number one, as to the surrounding area, have you determined how far from the closest residence the proposed facility is?
Yes, we have. We've calculated a distance, and this is from the center of the pole location, about 587 feet to the nearest residence.
And which way is that?
That's to the southeast.
Okay.
So that'd be along Willow Avenue.
Okay. And again, it's 578 feet?
587 feet.
Oh, 87 feet.
87, yes.
A little dyslexic. Okay, and now the setback from the property lines of the property itself. What is the proposed setback?
So the I'm actually going to switch here now. This is the overall site plan. I'm going to switch to drawing sheet Z5. Oh, excuse me. I take that back. Let me stay on Z4 first. The setbacks here are in detail to Z4, the partial site plan. And it shows you the setbacks of both of the tower and the compound to the side yard and the rear yards. The compound itself is 25 feet from the southern, from the south, which is a side yard, and it's 50 feet to the rear yard, which is to the east.
When you talk about the compound, what does that refer to?
That's a good question. Maybe we should go to that first. Let me then switch to sheet.
I feel like we're talking about the Kennedys here.
Absolutely. Let me give you. I can give you a little bit more overview of the site, and then we'll proceed with that. Then, so now I switch to drawing sheet Z5, and this shows an overall view of the compound. So the compound is a 50-foot by 50-foot fenced area. It's surrounded an 8-foot high chain link fence, It has a driveway that'll lead up to it that's going to be extended off the existing driveway I was discussing previously. In the center of the compound, there is a proposed pole, which we'll talk about when I get to another sheet. But the proposed pole supports the antennas and related equipment. There are three sectors, a sector being a grouping of antennas. Each sector consists of four antennas. So there's three sectors, four antennas, 12 antennas total. There's some pole-mounted radio equipment, which is mounted flush to the pole. These are remote radio heads, essentially creates the RF signal as close to the antennas as possible to kind of maximize the power at them. RF engineer will talk more about that. And then the cables from route down through the pole, through the inside of the pole, to a facility that's within the compound. So in the now the northeast corner of the compound, there's an equipment pad. The equipment pad has radio equipment on it. This is the base stations, which is essentially the interface between the radios, which are on the tower, and the landline network. There's also a backup generator to ensure that the site doesn't go down in the event of a power outage.
Run by natural gas?
In this situation, it's propane.
But all right.
So, yeah, there's an on-site 500-gallon propane storage tank, which is in the northwest corner, sort of the compound. Essentially, that's it. There'll be utilities routed from existing services in the area. There'll be a telephone demarcation and a meter center that's installed within the compound. And then there'll also be a telephone cabinet, which will be owned by the local service provider. I believe it's Verizon also in this area, not Verizon Wireless, but the other Verizon. The utilities then are routed over to the equipment cabinets, and that's essentially the magnitude of the facility we're talking about. So if we go, we can.
So the compound is the 50 by 50 foot space in which all the equipment is mounted and housed and surrounded by the chain link fence.
Correct. And there's we don't use the full 50 foot by 50 foot. We're using one corner, but it's built for co-location so that, you know, carriers coming in the future can also join, you know, onto the pole and you don't end up with poles all over. So we're building with a plan for the future as well. And the compound is essentially gravel. As I stated before, it's nestled very, very deeply in the woods. The compound area is just to Willow Avenue, which is the closest area we'd possibly be visible. It's 472 feet through the woods. So it's
when you say co-location, my only awareness of co-location would be co-location on the SAM monopole. Are you talking about putting up, did I understand you saying in the future you would be putting up another monopole?
It's to co-locate on the same monopole,
okay.
The compound is oversized to allow people to come onto
good.
This pole, and the pole is designed to support additional carriers to eliminate the need to build future poles.
Wanted to make sure I understood.
Well, why don't we turn to the sheet that shows the monopine, or what it did. It'll look better than that, I hope. But
barely architectural drawings, engineering drawings, let's call them. We're now looking at sheet Z6, which gives you a little bit better idea of the site. Now, keep in mind, this is just kind of the elevation of it. From a technical standpoint, we have another expert here, which will testify to the visibility, the surrounding areas, and whatnot. But there's also a tree cover here.
Will that be the planner?
That'd be the planner, correct. But there's a mature forest completely surrounding this area.
How tall are the trees in this mature forest?
I would say on average, I think I haven't taken an actual measurement, but I was just out there in the dark. I estimate it probably 60 feet or so, ballpark, but we could certainly verify that.
And what's the proposed height of the monopine?
The proposed height of the monopine to the top of the tree branches is 126 feet.
To the top of the tree branches. In other words, to the top of the, is there some sort of lightning rod on top of that?
It would actually be in the middle of the branches. So it's the same height, really, to the top of the tree branches.
So in other words, this thing's going to be twice as tall as the trees that are around there.
Right. In order to have our antennas, obviously have to be above the trees, and we have certain heights that we need for RF purposes. And then, as we stated, we're also planning for co-location, so you don't end up with multiple sites.
Right.
So the plan is to have not just enough area for one carrier, but to have enough for four. There's four carriers presently in this market that have, you know, independent networks. Each network requires its own set of antennas, its own set of ground-mounted equipment. And this typical separation between carriers for RF purposes is 10 feet. So our antennas actually, our centerline height of the antennas is at 110 feet. So you can go down 4 times 10 from that, 40 feet, right? So your lowest antenna sector would be roughly 70 feet, which is 10 feet above the tree line, roughly. So there is a rhyme to the reason on this.
Yep. Now, is it in the intent that the, quote, branches on this facility will encompass the width of the diameter of the antennas on the facility?
Absolutely. In fact, you can see this pole is modeled after a pole that's become quite famous locally. It's called the Delbarton tree pole, which is kind of the best tree pole that's been done in the industry. And it's got a real taper to it, so it looks more like a typical pine tree. And the antennas, when we place the antennas, they're placed within the taper of the branches. So
do you need the branches? I mean, would it be possible to have just a plain old monopole?
Absolutely. If that's what the board prefers, we'd gladly give just a plain monopole.
What I would suggest is the planner has two different scenarios to present. One is the monopine, and the other is basically a flagpole type design.
Okay.
I think it's probably best to wait, let him present the alternatives, and you can have that discussion.
The flagpole design, to touch on that, since we brought it up, there's technical reasons. I believe that was suggested by the town's planner originally, but there's technical reasons why that doesn't really work.
We'll let our RF expert address that.
Well, on the monopine, how far down the pole do the branches go?
The branches, I don't have an elevation on here, but I can scale it. It's roughly, it would take you to roughly about 60 feet, it looks like.
That's one of my concerns about those poles, because they look like a toothpick with growth on the upper half. And all of that forestation you're talking about, I'd say, well, can't say all of it, a great deal of it is deciduous trees. And the other part of it is, so it's not as well hidden. The other part of it is the area behind the club, right adjacent to where the pole will go, did take some significant damage from Hurricane Sandy. So that there isn't quite, I don't know if the picture represents the way the vegetation is in that entire area. I prefer to see you concentrate on a monopole, but I'll wait for that part of it to come. I don't like trees that only go halfway with branches.
Let me just stress that. One of the reasons we proposed the monopine is I believe your ordinance requires a stealth structure. We would, if the board wanted to vary from that, we certainly have no problem with that. But we were trying to accommodate the ordinance requirements.
I think part of the problem or might be just, you know, the design of it on the plans. I mean, the testimony's already been, that's not what we're going to provide. I mean, that looks like a scrub brush.
Right.
My testimony, what I've heard is that that's not what it's actually going to look like. It is going to be much more naturalistic looking.
Well, I've seen, and it's possible, I've seen crummy versions of them, but they're
good.
Any ugly.
Yeah, and some of them are pretty good and very naturalistic.
Okay.
So I just, you know,
yeah.
I mean, this is smack in the middle of the woods.
The other thing is, we are certainly willing to bring the branches down further to meld into the existing canopy. If they don't have to stop above it. They can come down.
I'm sure.
Now,
I guess
once we're in there,
they'd be happy to do a monopole. I am sure. It's more straightforward for them. But
I guess you might as well move on. I didn't mean to.
Yeah.
No, but what we'll say is we can wait till you see the planner's renditions and see a few of the other things in his testimony. And I happen to have been involved in the Delbarton tree pole, and it really is the Cadillac of what's been done now. They're not the same as as the Cranford pole on the Garden State Parkway is the best way to put it. Continue, if you will. How often is this site visited by personnel?
We typically say once per month. You know, the sites are remotely monitored. The technician doesn't come out. I mean, they'll come out for general maintenance, or any time that the remotely monitoring system, the NOC, says, hey, we need a visit out there for whatever reason. So we say once per month. The technician drives in a typical passenger vehicle. It's a small SUV or car. There's no traffic impact because of that. They park. Obviously, it's kind of back in the woods, so they park out of the way. It doesn't really affect any parking at the facilities.
And kind of jumping around a little bit, but the equipment itself, you said it was located in the compound. Can you describe the type of equipment?
Yes. Yeah, so
and where it's located?
Just going to go back to, we're now back to sheet Z5. On sheet Z5, you can see in the top right corner of the compound, it would be the northeast corner, is the equipment slab. And on that, there's four equipment cabinets. They're roughly 30 inches by 30 inches, and they're about 6 feet tall. They vary depending on what's actually delivered to the site, but more or less, that's what they are. They're gray in color, you know, and they have, it's just a door on them, so, equipment cabinets and equipment's inside of them. And then there's also a proposed propane generator, which is also enclosed. It's in a sound attenuated enclosure. We've checked it at the nearest property lines for the noise ordinance. We believe it'll meet the noise ordinance. Keep in mind, it's very close at the property lines. Just by calculation, the two property lines I'm referring to are to the south and the east, which are both Green Acres properties. There's nobody on these properties. This is also the 472 feet of woods. The nearest residential property line or any possible observer, we're way under the noise ordinance.
And what's the size of the generator?
So it's a 30 kilowatt.
Okay, and you said it was fueled by propane. Is that
propane,
correct?
Propane, yes.
Okay, and where is the propane tank in that?
The propane tank is here. I'm pointing to the northwest corner of the compound, sort of this oval shape.
Okay. Now, in regard to the, and I think this started. Mr. Shepherd asked a question about the compound setbacks. Can you give us the setbacks again to the compound and the setbacks to the monopole?
Sure. We're going to flip back now. I believe it's to sheet Z4. So we have to the south, which is a side yard. The compound is 25 feet from the side yard. To the east, it is 50 feet to the rear yard, which I believe meets the requirements of the setbacks. The pole, just as some additional information, is 48 and a half from the side yard to the south, and it is, where does the dimension? It's 74 feet from the pole to the rear yard to the east.
Now, have you had the opportunity to review the board's planner, engineer, et cetera, reports on this application?
Yes, I have.
Okay, I'm going to direct your attention to the engineering report dated October 6, 2016, specifically on the, page 2 under general comments, which I believe actually are all not in your bailiwick. So we'll go to the site plan comments.
Sure.
Number 5, the comment is to provide a walkway along the frontage of the same material and width to connect to the existing walkways adjacent to the subject property. Have you been to the site?
Yes, I actually just came from there.
And have you identified the walkways on the adjacent property?
Yes, there are a 4-foot wide macadam pathway, bike path.
Okay, and are we willing to install a matching bike path for that?
Yes, we are.
Okay. Now, on the next page, comment number 6 is provide a grading plan. I won't go into the details. Are you able to do that?
Yes.
Okay. Comment number 7 is provide a revised gravel surface detail.
Not a problem.
Okay, you can do that also. Comment number 8 is to provide revised concrete footing details.
Yeah, it's just a typo. It should be PSI. We agree with that comment. Yeah.
Okay. Comment number 9 is clarification of the proposed propane tank, whether it requires concrete bollards.
The compound is fenced, so they're really not vehicles in the compound on a typical basis. I don't know that they're required, but we're not opposed to providing them if so desired.
Okay. And it's not the intent that vehicles would drive into the compound, though, is that correct?
It's possible to access the compound. The gate is big enough to get a vehicle from it, but, you know, that's typically if we're bringing equipment in or out, you know, so there's the potential for a vehicle to be in there, but it's not common.
So the bollards could be placed?
Yes, we could certainly put bollards in there.
Okay. Number 10 is a tree removal and replacement schedule. Are you able to provide that?
Yes.
Okay. While we're talking about tree removal, because that's number 11, is a tree removal plan. Have you prepared a plan, and do you know how many trees have to be removed to build this facility?
Yes, there is a current, I don't know if I have the number right off the top of my head, but there is a tree removal plan shown. So we're looking now at sheet Z8, which gives you your tree removal and protection plan. And you can see the we have the species identified at the top. We have you know, in the total removals. So the number to be removed, I'm just going to count here. Looks like 21 trees to be removed.
Okay. And in that regard, are you willing to do it subject to the approval of the township meeting with the township to determine the removal?
Absolutely.
Comment number 12 addresses the square footage of disturbance, and can you address that briefly?
Yeah, I mean, there's just a debate as to whether the zoning classifies gravel as impervious, for, you know, in terms of stormwater management, the gravel is not considered impervious. However, there's several other factors in which we're calculating these areas for, I mean, including the Delaware River, the Canal Commission. So there's other people that have a say in how it's classified. So it's really just a calculation of bulk areas. But for any stormwater management, we're certainly happy to comply with engineering commentary on it.
So you intend to meet the stormwater management requirements?
Yes.
Okay. And is number 13 is clarification to the status of the wetlands. Can you please address that?
Yeah, the wetlands were delineated by another company, 2 p.m., and we had them picked up in a survey. It shows that the limits of the delineated wetlands, the LOI, I'm not sure if we have the LOI yet from there, but there's another company, E2PM, which is responsible for obtaining that, but certainly we'll get the LOI if so applicable.
And it will be provided, correct?
It will be provided, sure.
Now, under structural comments, can you address that comment?
Yeah, typically they're asking for a structural calculations to substantiate the structural integrity. Certainly every pole we provide is designed to meet code. The current code is TIA EIA 222G. Certainly the board has some opinions about the design of the structure. You know, we're talking about potentially having branches, no branches. Some variation in height, hypothetically, and the various carrier equipment that may go on the pole. It's because of all these factors, we typically save the calculations for the time where we go for a building permit, because we could end up redoing them. We've never had a problem making one of these stand up. We can do it every time. We certainly certify that it meets code, and we can offer a letter to that effect.
But the standing up part is easy. Can you keep it from falling down?
Absolutely. I mean, the codes that it's designed to are very conservative. They incorporate healthy factors of safety, and it will meet or exceed code.
Well, what is the, generally speaking, what is the method by which you plan to construct this so that there's not a risk of it falling down during a hurricane?
The code specifies the design standards. There's many factors that go into the design. For example, importance factor, which is relates to whether there's a substantial number of people who are by the pole or not. You know, if it's in the middle of a field versus next to a school, different importance factor. There's
importance?
Importance, it's called.
Okay.
These are structural terminologies. We mm-hmm. think of all the poles as equally important of standing up, but mm-hmm. from a structural term, it's called the importance factor. There's a wind speed that's established by ASCE 7. That's just a standard. That's the way every structure, you know, pretty much every structure in New Jersey, if not the entire United States, is designed to ASCE 7 standards. That's pretty much just a table that shows you the wind speeds by area. There's shape factors. There are, you know, for different appurtenances on the pole. And then there's various other factors of safety that are baked into the code. The code, when I said healthy factor safety, it's actually harder to pull out these days because of the way the code has changed. The code's call is based upon LRFD, which is load factored resistance design. So, for example, the pole may be designed to one time the dead load and 160% of the wind load. And there's various other factors, including reduced wind loads and increased ice loads and seismic loads and so on and so forth. So it becomes a very complicated subject to discuss, but it is a, from an engineering perspective, we're certainly welcome your engineer to review the final design, and it will meet or exceed all the design standards.
So in other words, you may want to condition any approval upon submitting that for final review once the design has been solidified for the review by the
So it hasn't been designed yet?
No, because has it been designed yet?
No, we would like to get you know, your input, and then when we agree on a design, a appearance of the pole, then we will work with the other carriers in the industry at the present time to see the kind of equipment they're deploying. The industry changes constantly, so if we can get closer to what's being deployed in the industry at the time we design it, there's much more likelihood that the tower is going to meet or exceed future design requirements.
And that testimony brings me actually to Mr. Healy's report, which was dated on October 20, 2016, page 3. And I'll go backward, but comment number 2 under tower designed. Do you have it?
Are we getting there? Tower design.
Okay. I believe we already discussed number A, that this is going to be a tree design and the branches are going to encompass the antennas. In other words, the antennas won't be sticking out from the branches. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Yeah. Okay. Now, a question was raised as to whether or not this pole could accommodate co-location. Without having other co-locators here, although we'll address them in our RF testimony, how do you plan to accommodate other co-locators on this facility?
Well, as stated, you know, we think the predominant tree height at the site is around 60 feet. Our antennas are at 110, so you actually have a slot at 100 feet, at 90 feet, at 80 feet, and at 70 feet, which is 10 feet above the predominant tree height at the site. So we actually have a vertical height on the pole that will suit three more carriers for a total of 4 carriers on the pole.
Okay. And can the pole be designed so that other carriers can be taken into account, even if they're not going on it initially?
Absolutely, and that is our intent, to design the pole, you know, as close to the time we're going to construct it to encompass as much of the equipment that is being deployed in the industry at that time.
So if a co-locator in the future came and asked to relocate on the pole and was given approval by the town, they could do so without the pole coming down or being modified, is that correct?
Correct.
Now, going back on the setbacks we've already discussed in Mr. Healy's report, and going, trying to just get to your situation. Oh, as to other carriers' equipment, could it be located within the proposed compound of 50 by 50?
Yes, the compound is has substantial size for 3 more carriers' equipment.
Okay. Now, comment number 7 on page 4 is landscaping. Are we proposing any landscaping?
We did not propose any landscaping in this situation. You know, we've determined that there's, you know, there was one board member stated that there's, you know, some deciduous trees around the property, and there are. In fact, there's a lot of them. There's, to the shortest view through the woods, is 472 feet of deciduous trees. So,
wait a minute. You know, this is a very interesting little. I was having trouble before when you were talking about 472 feet, and then all of a sudden you started to talk about the setback on the property was 65 feet, and I said, wait, there's a disconnect there. What is going on the other side of that property? Is that property like state land, or is it something where nothing's ever going to be built?
That's exactly what it is. It's along Willow Avenue, there's green acres, and so it's completely vegetated. There's a you know, mature forest on there that's, you know, it's just kind of left to the wild. So
it's township open space.
It's township open space.
And I think it's largely wetland, so I don't think it's going to be athletic fields at any point.
All right.
Right, and there's, you know, there's undergrowth, and then there's the deciduous trees that the board was discussing. So it was our feeling that to add landscaping would be, I'd have to take down trees to add trees. It doesn't make a lot of sense to add landscaping from.
Let me cut to the chase on these two ordinance requirements. The one says you have to landscape. The other one says that the equipment has to be within a structure. Those are two, in my mind, two very related requirements. They're trying to screen the equipment at the base. And I make the recommendation that based on its location, basically it's in the middle of a forest, instead of a chain link fence, can you do either a solid fence or a chain link with the evergreen privacy slats?
That would be, yes, we could certainly put the privacy slats would be, you know, brown or green privacy slats would further conceal it.
All right, and I'll leave it to the board if they have a preference, but I think in either case, it'll screen the equipment at the base, and in case somebody can see through the forest, at least there'll be that fence to block the equipment.
Yeah, and we have no problem with that, any type of fencing that you would want. Going further,
and Mr. Healy brought up a point, though. What's the difference between the equipment cabinets on a platform versus a shelter, which is the way this used to be done?
Yeah, the shelters, Verizon has moved away from the shelters. This changes constantly, but presently we're moving away from shelters. We were going to outdoor equipment, which is what is shown. The shelters are a lot bulkier. They're larger. You know, the typical equipment shelter for Verizon is 12 feet by, it's either 28 or 30 feet. There's a couple different versions of it, but it's a fairly substantial building with a fairly substantial footprint. The equipment cabinets are installed outdoors. They're about, if you can imagine a refrigerator, they look a lot like a refrigerator that's kind of a neutral gray color. And they're just basically that cabinet is internally temperature controlled, whereas the shelter, the entire volume of the shelter is temperature controlled and you can walk inside of it. So it's actually just a smaller installation, especially for sites like this that are so well visually screened at the equipment compound level. It doesn't make aesthetically, it doesn't make a significant difference other than this is actually just a lot smaller.
Now, dealing with, excuse me, other comments, is there any lighting that's required for the site or proposed for the site?
No, I mean, there's the only thing that we have is a work light at the platform. The work light is on a countdown timer, so if a technician has to come at night and turns the light on, it shuts itself off, and that's the only lighting that's proposed.
And how is that directed, that light?
It's directed inwards on the property towards the equipment cabinets.
Okay. Comment C is the structural integrity we've addressed. D is requesting a reference survey. Can the survey be provided?
Yeah, that's the wetlands question. I think you addressed that already.
Okay. And comment E, the tree replacement requirement, we would agree with whatever the calculation is. And comment F, which is the macadam pathway we've addressed. Going now to the health department report dated October 3rd, 2016.
Can I stop you real quick?
Yes.
And I'm not sure if this is the site engineer or the radio frequency person, but one of the variances, a few of the variances, are the setbacks. Is there a reason why? So this, you chose kind of the back rear corner of the site, and that's creating a need for these setback variants. Is there a reason why that particular area of the site was chosen?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Chad.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, we chose it mostly for visual reasons. I mean, when we look at this property, you know, the property is largely developed already. It's there's parking lots and there's swim club and there's tennis courts and there's other things on the property, except for this corner, which is you know, it's forested. So from a visual standpoint, the forested area aligns quite nicely, sort of equidistant with all the surrounding residences. So, you know, sort of the stars aligned on this one, where the best location in terms of the residences was also the best location in terms of the visual screening, which really led to the choice of this location. The setback variances that are required, I believe, relate to the height of the pole. And this is sort of this, you know, from an engineering standpoint, we find it a little funny, is this fall zone concept. You know, we, of course, designed the poles not to fall down. They're designed to exceed the code.
And we find that kind of funny.
Right. So, right. Yeah, sure. I mean, that's understandable. We're looking at things from a, you know, different perspective. But the pole's obviously designed not to fall down, but the setback variances that are required relate to the height of the pole, where you have a setback requirement that's a ratio of the height of the pole. I don't remember what it is off the top of my head.
Yeah, I think the setback, I'm sure the planner will speak to this. It does relate to the fall zone, but I think it is also an aesthetic thing, too. Obviously, from an ordinance perspective, you know, you don't normally want a tower, you know, too close to the property line, but you're going to address the distances to surrounding properties, et cetera, and why you chose it. But
okay, but in this case, and I just like to address this, there is, and I don't want to, are there any structures within the, quote, fall zone of the adjacent properties?
On the adjacent properties, no. Those are the green acres. They're not developed. There's no people. There's nothing. It's just well,
so there won't be any structures.
There
in that
will
area.
Not
that
be
correct?
Any structures in the future either.
And
wait a minute. And since he asked that question, let me ask the other one. Within the property that this is going to be erected on, are there any structures within the fall zone?
No. And you know, if we're taking the fall zone to mean the you know, the height of the pole, we switch back here. I'm going to just go back to sheet one more.
Did you make a note, Mr. Rosenthal?
Back to sheet Z4.
Just 827.
Okay. Right, we're on sheet Z4, where to the nearest pool is well over 200 feet, and the highest branch, our highest lightning rod, the same, is 126. So yep. We're way over 200 feet to the nearest anything on the property. It's really kind of set in the woods, mm-hmm. just surrounded by forest.
So to bring that full circle, with nothing within the fall zone, there are no structures within the fall zone, either on or off the property?
Either on or off the property, there are no structures. That's correct.
Okay. Now, going to the Health Department report of October 3rd, 2016, the decibel level. Well, first of all, what is the purpose of this generator?
The generator there, there's really two backup systems. There's batteries, and there's the generator. The generator will keep the site running basically continuously. During an emergency like we had during Sandy, large portions of the network went down, so they have a on-site fuel storage tank where we can bring fuel to the site and keep everything on air and keep the network up and running. The generator only runs continuously during an emergency situation. During that time, we are exempt from all noise ordinances. The generator is tested once weekly, which keeps the, you know, the oil fresh and the generator running cleanly. It's tested typically at Wednesday at noon, runs for half an hour, run remotely. It's run from the NOC, just they turn it on and they turn it off. And during that time, by our estimations, the noise will be right at the limit at the property line. This again is the property line of the uninhabited property. Anywhere else, any residents, we're way under the noise ordinance. We have a huge factor of safety. So the only area that's, you know, even slightly questionable is those two back corners to the south and to the east, and that at those times it'll be close to the noise ordinance, 65 decibels.
Okay, and you stated already that it'll be done during the week at noon.
Yes, Wednesdays at noon is the typical schedule.
Okay, and just, is there a methodology of making sure that there's no ozone alert or anything that would affect the running of the generator for this testing?
Yes, actually, the NOC, which is also controlling this schedule, remotely monitors, you know, the any of those, the DEP alerts, the ozone alerts, and can actually vary the testing schedule to accommodate that.
Because it's still all done remotely.
It's all done remotely, right. Nobody has to come here. Okay. It's all No, so they'll actually change the testing schedule of all the generators in the region all simultaneously.
All right. Now, I'm going to address the Office of Fire Prevention report dated September 29, 2016. Have you had the opportunity to review this report?
Yes, I have.
All right. Starting with the first comment, suggesting that the Type 1 permit is required. Do you have an opinion on that?
Yeah, our understanding of the code is slightly different. As I understand it, the Type 1 permit, as per NJAC 572, Section 2.7, is for storage of a liquid between 60 and 660 gallons. The tank we're proposing is propane, which is a compressed gas. So we don't believe a Type 1 permit is required.
If it is required, will we obtain one?
We have no objection if it is required.
Number two, there's a comment about the existing driveway being widened and the tree branches maintained. Do you have a suggestion regarding that?
Yeah, we've, I just went out there to look at this. I don't necessarily agree with the approach of just blanket widening the entire driveway to 15 feet. There's sort of a narrow driveway that leads back to the area that's presently about 10 feet wide. And then we're adding our little extension and parking area, which is predominantly 12 feet wide. There's a lot going on back here. There's obviously the forested area. Going to a full 15 feet wide is going to cause us to remove more trees. It's also going to...
I would say that you really need to work that out with our fire prevention officer because, I mean, he's very amenable to working something out, but you're going to have to provide what he needs for the fire. So I would say you just want to say you'll work it out with him.
Well, we're certainly willing to do that. Yeah. We would meet on site with him, your engineer, and others that might be involved to come up with a satisfactory plan.
Yeah.
Because that would address also the snow removal at what depth. I mean, if it's a quarter of an inch, do we need to worry about the snow or at what inch? So I think that would be the appropriate thing to work it out at the time. We'd be willing to do that if the board was agreeable to that as a condition. And I guess that would address all the reports. I have no further question of Mr.
I have a couple questions and comments about the, I guess this is the appropriate time, the use of the property and how it pertains to you. This is a pretty inaccessible site. That's good and it's bad. This whole, that is where you're putting the tower. The problem I have is that this entire property is extremely accessible. There's no limits on it. People go in and out of the driveway after hours. There's occasional parking overnight. When the club is closed, whether they know it or not, there are often 2 a.m. swim parties. Right, Mike, and the other issue that affects us that can affect you is we've got an unapproved parking lot in the front part of this parking lot that the Cedar Hill Prep School uses. And usually, and in this case, we would advocate shared facilities. The problem is, I think a condition that we need to put on this is that there should be a gate on Cedar Grove Lane that's closed and locked unless the swim club is in operation. Prevent people from going in and out of there at will. Protect your facility and have some other issues that the town has in terms of traffic and left turns and things like that that are coming out of that driveway that are not authorized.
I would... That's something I would have to go back to the lessor to Horizon Wireless would agree to it, but we don't control the property.
I mean, what if our intention is to make that a condition of approval?
It would still, I'd still have to go back to the lessor.
Restricted.
I can't bind them. It's their vote that would, they'd have to buy. We would certainly be willing to, I understand what you're saying, you want it on. At the street frontage,
a gate with access for police, fire, the club, and your facilities. I would think that the swim club would be happy to do that.
If the board put it as a condition, it's certainly something we would go back to them and encourage, and we would pay for it. But it's a matter of, I can't just say yes.
Well, I could put it in as a condition, and I can put the escape hatch, which is if you can't work it out with the swim club that's going to make money on the renting the property here, then you come back to the board.
I have no problem with that.
I'm sure that the property owner would need to know that normally this board's been very generous in allowing property banking, parking lot banking, parking spots, sharing facilities and things like this. And what needs to happen is there needs to be a plan for that shared facility. Now you're moving in, you're storing propane gas, you've got a facility that people in theory could be vandalizing for hours back there and no one would know it. And people do drive in and out of that parking lot at all hours of the day or night. They don't often walk back there because it's not very easy to see what's going on. But cars do go there.
And I agree, Mr. Thomas.
I think you also might need to talk to, maybe I'm being more of an alarmist, to the property owner about how you keep their use separate from your use when they're operating as a recreation and a swim club. That's another concern that I have.
The compound is secured. We actually have a locked gate at the compound, so it's not just open for anybody to come in. Additionally, all the equipment cabinets are alarmed from to the knock. So if someone were to intrude on a piece of equipment, it sets off an alarm at a remote location, and they can dispatch police or a technician or whatnot to investigate the cause of the alarm. So the concern over our equipment is certainly less than perhaps the board's concerns over other access to the property.
Okay.
But again, we're certainly willing to accept the condition. It would take back the board. And then
I mean, I'm a little bit...
Well, when I say the board, I mean the lessor board.
I'm a little bit, I guess if you want to say prejudiced from that point of view, but I think that's a pretty simple, inexpensive solution with a gate that will keep people where they belong and keep other people where they don't, who don't belong, out.
And although I may concur with you, I can't bind the landowner without your vote. And
any other questions for this witness? Well,
I have a question. So this is going to look like the Del Barton monopine.
Yes.
Okay, so there will be branches all the way around.
Correct.
And the branches can go down to the tree line.
Correct.
So when you're designing for the three other carriers or four other carriers?
Three others.
Okay. Are you going to leave empty spaces for them, or how are you going to do that?
Right. I mean, it's just really, it's an elevation. So our antennas are at 110 feet. Their elevation would be at 100 feet, and then 90 feet, 80 feet, and 70 feet. We don't put mounts or anything at those locations. When the carrier comes in, I assume in front of this board to get their equipment proposed on this existing pole at that time, then they would propose the mounts that they need to support what they're deploying.
But I think the question was, what about the branches will already be there.
The branches are there, right.
So they would remove the branches, or?
The branches move around, so you can relocate them to an extent. So everything's nestled amongst the branches, including our installation.
All right, so you're going to put up the full branching, and if and when a co-locator comes in, the branching will be modified for their antennas?
If required. You know, all of these poles are designed for, you know, as many carriers as you ask them to be designed for. So the place is available, but, you know, we can't anticipate what it could install. So, yes, they may modify the branches, but they leave them in place. So everything ultimately would be encompassed within the branches.
Okay, thank you.
It's kind of like a fake Christmas tree where you can move the branches around, but on a much bigger scale.
Much bigger scale. I mean, it's almost the exact same technology, to be honest with you.
Okay.
Any other questions? We'll open quickly to the public. If anyone, this is a questioning period now. we're not looking for a statement or an opinion. If you have a question regarding this witness's testimony, now's the time to ask. Go ahead. We need you to identify yourself for.
Mr. Sensi, oh, good.
My name is Anthony Ganem. I live on 142 Cedar Grove Lane. I do have a couple of questions concerning the radiation of the poles. What effect will that have?
We didn't have that witness yet. Just have, we need questions concerning what you heard him testify to.
There's someone else who's going to come talk about the health concerns.
There's another person
for that. All right. Now, you mentioned that you have a generator, propane generator, and it's going to run once a week for a half hour. You said the decibel is below the noise. What is the decibel reading?
So
when you say it's below, what is it? Is it below 100? Is it below 125? Is it below 150? You should know this answer.
I do know the answer, but it's not a simple answer, right? So the generator.
Yes, it is.
Yes, it
give
is.
Give me an answer.
I'll give you an answer. Thank generators you. Are rated at 23 feet distance. The generator, the noisiest generator, there's actually several different models that are available. The noisiest is 67 decibels at 23 feet. The nearest property line is more than 23 feet. So every time you double that 23 feet, you take off 6 decibels. So at 46 feet, it would be 6 decibels less than that. So it's 67 down to 61. So at 43 feet, you'd be at 61 decibels. So at your property, you wouldn't even be able to hear it.
Okay. So I understand that you were going to put this tree pole up. I've seen them. Not like this one, but close to this, and I think they're pretty good looking, if you ask me, compared to a regular pole. Other than that, I have another question here. Where is it? So you answered most of my questions. Now, are you renting this property, or are you buying it from the swim club?
We have a lease.
Oh, so you have a lease. Verizon is a commercial company, and you're setting the precedence now on Cedar Grove Lane that anybody on Cedar Grove Lane can now rent their property to a commercial entity. That's the way I see it.
Our application is before this board for use variance specific to this property, as the board attorney would advise them and as I would represent. It does not set any precedent as to any other property. We have to make our own proofs for our own application to establish our need for the use.
Yeah, and well, just speaking from the zoning code perspective, it's a permitted use in this zone. The reason they're before this board is they don't meet certain of the requirements, the setbacks that we talked about and some of the other variances that they need. But in this zoning district, a cell tower is a permitted use. So they're not setting any precedent here. This is
okay, but that just real brief, the way I understood it, if it's a commercial company renting, then that means other people can rent their property out to a commercial company. That's the way I see it. Now, going to the DEP, I understand that going over a brook is a footbridge, not a mobile bridge. How are you going to get your equipment back there? You need cranes.
There's an existing driveway, and we're
and there's a, I believe there's a footbridge that's going across the brook to the swim club in the back.
There's, I believe there's a culvert down there. There's big enough to get a vehicle through. I just drove back there, literally right before I came here.
But the way I understood it, it's supposed to be a footbridge, not a mobile bridge. I think that's something for the board to look into. And I have one more question. Where is it? Oh, I don't know how the way. Can I look at this print? Oh,
absolutely.
Now, the setback from the property line to any construction here
Okay, you're referencing sheet Z5 and the compound. If I may actually direct you back to sheet Z4, it's the same compound, but it'll show you with the setbacks. So we're back on sheet Z4 now, and this will actually show you the setbacks. It's such a large piece of property. See, I'm pointing to the bottom right-hand corner of detail 1, okay. Z4. This is the equipment compound, mm-hmm. and this dashed line around here are the setbacks. There's 50 feet rear yard.
From
the rear yard, right? And this is a side yard over here is 25 feet. So we're right inside the setback to the compound, and then you can see the setbacks to various different aspects of it down here.
The reason why I'm asking, I'm just passing on some information to you. There's a pipeline that goes in here. So that's something to look into.
Certainly.
811 is the number. So, yeah.
Anyone else?
We always, yes.
Okay, we'll close to the public. Next witness.
Great, thank you.
Okay, if you raise your right hand for me, do you solemnly swear or affirm to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth? And tell us who you are.
Sean Hainberg, S-E-A-N-H-A-Y-N-B. Sean Hainberg, S-E-A-N-H-A-Y-N-B-E-R-G.
Mr. Hainberg, for the benefit of the board, can you give me your educational background, your work experience, and the capacity in which you're appearing here this evening?
Sure. I have a Bachelor's of Science in Electrical Engineering from Rutgers University College of Engineering. I'm employed by VCOM Telecommunications Engineering, which is a radio frequency engineering firm located in Cranberry, New Jersey. I have a total of 27 years experience in the commercial wireless industry, the cellular industry, in radio frequency engineering.
Okay, and I've offered him and the board's accepted him as a radio frequency engineer. Now, Mr. Hainberg, in preparation for your hearing or your testimony here this evening, have you had an opportunity to review the Verizon wireless system in this area?
I have.
Okay, and there are some reports that were submitted to the board with this application prepared by VCOM Associates. Are you familiar with those reports?
Yes, I am.
I want to start with the one that is dated RF emission study, as the gentleman raised this question before, and it might be a good time to just take care of it. What is the purpose of your RF emission study, which is dated July 13, 2016?
The purpose of the study is to study the RF emissions for the Verizon wireless cell site and compare that to the federal standards.
Can you tell us what the federal standards, how they play into place?
Yes, the federal standards are set by the Federal Communication Commission for all RF emissions for wireless sites. VCOM studied the RF emissions for the proposed site, and this includes Verizon's four frequency bands that are operating at the proposed site. Using FCC-established methods and procedures, we computed the total field strength surrounding the proposed facility to reach a maximum of 0.4% of the FCC standard. This is well below FCC limits. 0.4% is more than 200 times below the federal limits, so you could have 200 of these towers and still comply with the federal emission standard.
So as a consequence, if you had three co-locators, since it's less than 200, it would be well within the emission.
Exactly. It would be well below the federal limits.
Okay.
Therefore, this site and even three other or four other additional sites would comply by a large margin with the federal regulations for RF emissions.
Okay. And in that regard, that those are the standards that Verizon Wireless and the other wireless license carriers are required to meet. Is that correct?
Correct. They are absolutely required by their license to meet that.
Okay. Now, in regard to this application, a certain report was prepared entitled RF Analysis and Report, dated July 13, 2016. Can you tell us what the purpose of that report was?
Yes. We studied the proposed facility, the radio frequency propagation from the proposed facility, in addition to Verizon Wireless's existing on-air network of sites that are surrounding the proposed facility. In addition to the report, we also prepared two radio frequency exhibits, a larger size that I am also prepared to present to the board tonight.
Okay. And just before we go to that, I just want to get an overview. What is Verizon Wireless's position in the industry as a wireless carrier, and what licenses does it hold?
Yeah, Verizon is one of the largest wireless cellular communication carriers in this area. There are three others that also provide service to this particular area. They're licensed to provide service by the FCC. Verizon actually holds four licenses to provide service in four different frequency bands. There's the 700, 800, 1900, and 2100 megahertz frequency bands that they are licensed by the FCC to provide wireless service in this area. Verizon service is their latest 4G, fourth generation LTE broadband data service and their voice over LTE services for this area.
Okay, and are all four of those licenses meant to be installed at this facility?
Yes, they will be.
Okay, now you've indicated you have a couple of exhibits that you'd like to present to the board. Why don't you get them?
Okay. Should I label them?
Yeah, and we'll use them on that easel. And we'll mark them as A1 and A2.
Yes, this is a radio frequency propagation map. The base map is a topographical map of the area, and on the map I've also shown the in the center is the proposed Quailbrook site that we're here for tonight, and surrounding the proposed site in the center are the existing on-air cell sites for the Verizon Wireless Network. I'll review those briefly. Starting to the east is their Franklin 3 site. It's on a rooftop on Easton Avenue in this red dot. Just to the north is actually a site that's not on air yet, but is approved and will soon be on air. That's the Franklin Avalon condo site. It's on a rooftop on Easton Avenue as well. To the north of that is Piscataway Kingswood, Kingsbridge site. It's also on a rooftop on Centennial Avenue. Then the Franklin 2 site. It's on a building on Davidson Road. Franklin 8 site, it's on a building on Davidson Avenue. Franklin 6 site, it's on a lattice tower on Wiley Drive. To the far northwest, the Franklin 4 site, it's on a rooftop on Cottontail Lake. To the
Lane. No lake.
That's a typo, sorry.
All right.
To the west, Franklin site. It's on a monopole on Valleywood Drive. Also, to the south of the proposed site is the Somerset site, which is also at this facility. It's the lattice tower outside. And it's approved and planned to be, it's in the planning stages for deployment now. So it'll be a future site that's at this property here on DeMont Lane. And to the south of Franklin 5 site, a monopole on Churchill Avenue. I should also say a lot of these, especially the towers, the other carriers have co-located on. They do have a similar grid structure for this particular area that I'm aware of. And you know, for this site, we also looked in the surrounding area, and there are no other structures in this area that we have a coverage problem. And that is the reason why we're here tonight. Also show you the coverage. We showed the radio frequency coverage for the existing Verizon Wireless network of cell sites that are surrounding the proposed site in this area with this overlay that's highlighted in green, showing reliable service, where you have coverage, where you would reliably be able to make and receive and maintain wireless service. And the coverage gap in the center of this exhibit surrounding the proposed site, the Quailbrook site, is where there's a lack in service. And the reason for this site to fill in that gap in service In addition, two neighboring sites, the Franklin site and the Franklin 8 site, are both at their capacity limit. So the secondary purpose of the proposed site, in addition to fill in that gap of service, is also to offload the capacity from users that are on those two sites as well.
Okay, I want to interrupt you for a second. Use the firm term, I'm sorry, reliable service. What do you mean by reliable service?
Reliable service is where Verizon wireless users can use their cellular devices indoors, outdoors, on all their frequency bands, able to make connections, whether they're for data or voice, and maintain them reliably on their network.
And this is a standard that Verizon Wireless sets, is that correct?
Correct. This is their standard for service.
Okay. There is no FCC-required standard, is that right?
The FCC requires a license to provide substantial service. They don't define it exactly, but there is a requirement.
The requirement being substantial service and reliably better than mediocre, I think, is the phrase. But it's not a...
Is when you say reliably better than mediocre, that's not really the federal standard. That's just Verizon Wireless trying to identify how low they'll go.
No. The federal FCC requirement, I think I provided it to Mr. Bradshaw in the past, is it is reliably better than mediocre service. And that's in the FCC regulations. A true government speak, I would guess, that it's not a quantitative standard, but subjective more than objective.
I was also out in this area earlier today, and it does have very low coverage. And in some of these areas, it was 0 to 1 bars where users would not be able to make wireless service connections.
So what is the intent of this site then?
Okay, the intent of this site is primarily to provide coverage and fill in the gap of service that's in the center of this exhibit right here. Actually, my next exhibit will show that the proposed Quail Brook site does, in fact, fill in that gap in service in the center of this exhibit. In addition, it also relieves capacity from two neighboring sites, the Franklin 8 and Franklin site. So it is dual purpose, but the primary purpose is to provide fill-in coverage for that area.
Can you again tell me the name of the blue dot that's below the location that we're talking about?
Yeah, this is the Somerset site, which is the lattice tower at this location.
At this location. And is that up and running now?
It is not, and I'm not showing the coverage that is providing. I do.
Why not?
I have a third. It's not on there yet, but I have a third exhibit that will show that as well. If you'd like, I can show that too.
Mr. Shepard, I can give some background on that. That site was put out to bid by the township. Verizon Wireless was awarded the bid. I'm going to say, and the lease was signed in September. It was administratively approved, as it is a priority site under your ordinance, which I think Mr. Healy can qualify. And the building permit may or may not have been issued yet. But I know the lease was just signed in September.
If you're interested, I can show you the coverage of that facility in my third exhibit.
Okay, let's do that.
Okay. First, we'll go to A2. So this is A2, which is the same radio frequency propagation and based topographical map as A1, in addition, the coverage shown of the proposed Quail Brook site, which is showing that it does provide fill-in coverage to the center area where there was a gap in service. And if you want, I'll show you A3 that also adds the Somerset site coverage as well. Okay, A3 shows the same coverage base map with the coverage from the existing Verizon Wireless surrounding on-air cell sites, in addition to the proposed Quail Brook site and the future Somerset site that fills in the coverage area in the center of this exhibit. The proposed Quail Brook site, in addition to providing good fill-in coverage for this particular area, also relieves capacity from the neighboring sites. And for these reasons, the proposed Quail Brook site is a suitable site from a radio frequency standpoint for the Verizon wireless network.
And the conjunction of the Quail Brook site, this present site, with the Somerset site, will that basically provide coverage in the gap area that you showed on A1?
Correct. For A3, we're showing actually both gaps covered, the one surrounding the Quail Brook site and the Somerset site. So it does fill in the gap in service in these areas for the Verizon Wireless Network, and for that reason, due to their location, that they are suitable for the Verizon Wireless Network.
Now, I believe you already addressed this, but I just want to summarize it because it was raised in Mr. Healy's report. The area that you're seeking for the Quail Brook site, this site that we're here before the board, did you look for existing structures that could satisfy the need?
We did, and there are no existing structures in this area. The entire area is primarily residential. There are residential developments all along, actually in this entire gap of service, which are kind of surrounded by Cedar Grove Lane. There's Willow Avenue, New Brunswick, and also all the way out to DeMont Lane. Residential developments, no large structures. There's also the golf course that's in here as well. No large structures either.
Now, we were talking about co-location in the engineering testimony. Can co-locators use this site?
Yes, it's designed for co-location, and I believe another carrier, I think it was T-Mobile, expressed an interest to Verizon to co-locate on this facility. I'm aware they are co-locating at a number of other tower sites surrounding this, so the site is designed for co-location.
Okay. Now, the height that's been chosen for Verizon Wireless on this site, why was that height selected?
Well, the height was selected for two reasons. The first was the reason stated earlier, so that other carriers will be able to co-locate and have their antennas operate above the tree line to cover the surrounding area. But primarily, it is required to cover the gap in service that we were showing on A1. It's a fairly large gap. Some areas extend out to as much as, this is A1 now I have up here, up to a mile away from the site. And this is the minimum height required to fill in this size gap in service, which is fairly large.
So in other words, this site in conjunction with the Somerset site works into the network to basically fill the area of need.
Correct.
I have no further questions of Mr. Hamburg.
Any board questions?
I have a few more. The location here at the municipal building, how tall is that antenna going to be?
The lattice tower is 223 feet, and the antenna center line is 196 feet.
Okay, so doesn't what you've done is you've provided a map that shows coverage without both of those. Then you've shown a map that has coverage with top one, and then you've shown coverage with both, but you don't show, and I think you should have shown, what the coverage was where the one that's going to come online. Do you have that as well?
Not in that size, but it's in the report. I could
what page?
On page 14. So it looks like this.
Okay. All right. So that's what it would look like
without the proposed. So the gap in service is still very large.
It almost seems like. Well, how far does the 277 foot tower extend the range of the signal? Is it greater than a mile?
Less than a mile. I mean, less than a mile. Probably a half a mile to. Let me see if my memory serves me correctly. It's between a half a mile and three quarters of a mile.
Okay. Now.
You're up to about here.
Okay. So
it's really intended to cover, this entire area. This is a pretty large area. This site is intended to cover all the way out to DeMont Lane,
yep.
And even up here.
Yeah.
So this entire, so it's a very large area, and some of that area is 2 miles away from that Somerset site.
Yeah. And but with the addition of that other tower, once that other tower is up, are you saying that there still will be areas where one cannot make a telephone call?
Correct. I'm sorry, for the record, when we say the other tower, you're referring to the Somerset?
Somerset.
Yes, correct. There's still, as we're showing on page 14, a fairly large gap in service where you're not going to be able to have reliable service and make calls throughout that area.
Well, reliable service is one thing. I'm talking about, what is it, Mr. Stanziali, better than mediocre?
Substantially better than mediocre.
Substantially better than mediocre.
Yeah, I mean, we're showing service that provides service to customers indoors and outdoors for all the frequency bands. So there could be an area where you're outside your home on good ground elevation where you get spotty coverage, but you go inside and see what, you know, attenuates going through the building and you're not getting good service. So that's not an area where we have, we call reliable service.
Okay.
I might add just for the record too that the municipal tower here at 223 feet, the space was dictated in the bid where we could be. There are other carriers already on that tower, and there are also police antennas on that tower.
Now, the police antennas are not Verizon signals?
No.
What type of signals are those?
Your public safety has their own frequency bands that are independent of commercial
and
wireless.
Do those bands, can they broadcast further than the Verizon?
Some of them can, yes. Depends on the frequency band. For example, the lower frequency bands, like 150 megahertz, go a lot farther typically.
But one of the requirements under the lease, and I could always provide it if you need it, is that we not interfere with the police broadcast.
It's generally the rule around here.
Yeah, yeah, because they need their own facility.
Any other questions?
One question. I think there was a discussion, I think the site engineer indicated something about the technical issues with the flagless flagpole. Can you?
I think he was referring to the flag. Is that true?
No. I wanted to address that. Co-location factors with a flagpole. Are they restricted versus a monopole or a tree pole?
Well, from a radio frequency standpoint, you know, whether it's a monopole or flagpole, your antennas are confined within that structure. So from a radio frequency standpoint, as long as it's designed for your antenna height and the number of carriers you have, there's no real radio frequency issue that would prevent a flagpole or a monopole.
Okay, but from a co-location point of view, can Verizon Wireless fit all of its antennas at one height, or would it need different heights?
They could also separate two heights so that you could have one set above the other. So that's what they would typically do.
So Verizon Wireless would actually take up two horizontal planes on that pole.
Yeah, so if you had four carriers, that could push the lower carrier a little bit lower. Yeah.
So what it sounds like is what we heard with the monopine is 100, 90, 80, 70. So what I'm hearing is you would need to be at 190, and that might...
No, Verizon would be at the same height,
okay.
But some of the other carriers may be lower on there.
And they may not, so they may not want to locate there.
That's not any different from the tree arrangement. They would both be co-locating one at 100 or whatever it is, and then down 10 feet.
But I think I'm hearing that the lowest, even the fourth, with either a regular monopole or monopine, we always hear they have to be 10 foot separate. You know,
it's typically what they would 70, have.
But then with the flagless flagpole, move them down below further.
The flagless flagpole, you know, assuming it's the same width as the monopole, it would be the same case.
So there's no difference.
Okay.
Right.
Okay, now what about the remote radio heads? They cannot be inside the pole.
If there's no room, then you'd have to put them down the bottom, and you do lose a little bit of signal with that, signal range.
Any other questions?
I have no further questions.
Open to the public, then. Is there anyone who'd like to ask a question concerning this witness's testimony?
You were concerned about health. This is the gentleman to talk to.
Well, that was the first report he addressed.
Right. Okay. We're just kind of helping the guy here, that's all.
Yeah.
Now, as you know, the tower is going up in a swim club. There's a lot of toddlers there, women expecting, teenagers. There's a school right next to the swim club. What effect would this have on them?
Yeah, as we studied,
they're out there all day.
Answer the question.
In the sun, swimming close, very close to the tower.
No effect. I mean, we studied the radio frequency emissions and compared it to all the federal safety rules and regulations, and we are well below those limits by a factor of more than 200 times. So the emissions are 0.4%. of the federal standards. And that is the maximum surrounding the facility. Typically, it's gonna be within 100 feet of the facility or less. So I believe the swimming pool that you reference is, you know, many hundreds of feet away. So it would be well below that, in fact, even perhaps 0.1% of the federal standard. So it's a very, very low level.
And the radiation from this tower won't have any effect on the trees around or the ground?
No effect whatsoever. Nope.
And would there be any noise coming from this tower on windy days, rainy days, or at any time?
Do you want another expert to talk about noise from the tower?
Would there be any buzzing sounds or humming sounds from the towers?
Yeah, there's... The only other, we spoke about the generator previously. The only other thing on the site that makes any amount of noise are the radio cabinets. Very, very quiet. I mean, it's like, think about a computer cooling fan, like you have it on a desktop computer, something really similar to that. So
otherwise, there's no sounds coming out of this tower whatsoever, buzzing sounds, humming sounds?
Nothing. The tower doesn't
wind
make
resistant
any.
Sounds, or,
it has about the same aerodynamic characteristics as a tree. So no more than the rustling leaves in the trees.
Okay, no further questions. Thank you.
Mr. Masters?
Okay, we're closed to the public for now, so next witness.
You're going to need that mic back. That's over there. Okay, Mr. Masters, raise your right hand. You solemnly swear or affirm to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
Name for the record.
William F. Masters, Jr., M-A-S-T-E-R-S.
Mr. Masters has appeared before this board a number of times as a licensed professional planner. I'd offer him that.
He's accepted.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Masters, in preparation for the hearing tonight, have you had the opportunity to review the zoning ordinances of the Township of Franklin?
I have.
And basically, can you give an overview of your understanding of the application, the variances that are being sought?
Yes, the... applicant is before the board this evening seeking use variance relief of the D3 variety, which is a deviation or departure from a conditional use standard. There are actually three standards here that require D3 conditional use variance relief. The first and foremost is the minimum required setback for the tower. The wireless ordinance in Franklin Township requires a 200% horizontal distance to vertical tower height, which in this case translates into a minimum required setback of 252 feet. The proposed setback to the westerly side property line, now this is a measurement to the actual antennas that are being proposed on the pole. I think the dimensions that you heard earlier were to the pole itself. So the variance relief request to the westerly side property line here is 43.4 feet, and to the rear property line is 69.6 feet. And again, that is to the closest antennas to those two property lines.
In addition to the D3 setback requirement, there is a variance for D3 conditional use variance relief due to the fact that there's no landscaping proposed. There was testimony earlier that with the proposed tree removal that the applicant would be willing to meet with the township professionals in order to work out a tree replacement program. And third is the requirement that the equipment be housed within a building. You heard testimony from the applicant's engineer that here the proposal is for equipment cabinets, which would be contained within the 50 by 50 foot fenced compound area. And again, the applicant indicated that it would be willing to provide privacy slats within that chain link fence for purposes of ensuring that the ground equipment would be properly screened visually. Turning back to the setback issue, your planner correctly notes in the in his report on page 3, there's a dual purpose to the tower setback requirement. The first is to provide visual separation from adjoining properties. The second is to provide a fall zone on the property in the event of a failure, a structural failure of the pole. I would suggest to the board that with regard to the aesthetic issue, that the proposed location nestled up against the south corner, rear corner of the building envelope of the property is a better alternative, owing to the fact that it's situated within the existing wooded area on the property, and due to the fact that the two properties actually from which the variance relief is required relative to the setback are both owned by the township. As was indicated earlier, those properties are Green Acres properties. In terms of future development, it is unlikely owing to the environmental constraints on that property. So one of the properties is 8.28 acres. The other one is 24.63 acres. Again, both of the properties owned by Franklin Township and Green Acres Restricted. The other purpose or objective of the tower setback requirement is the so-called fall zone situation. While we don't believe that that's a concern, it's obviously a concern of your wireless ordinance. I would suggest to the board, if we were to move the proposed pole so that it was either compliant or more nearly compliant, such as moving it out to the edge of the tree line within the subject property, then it would actually be, there would actually be existing structures and activities on the property that would be within the fall zone of the proposed pole. So I believe it's the location where it is now is a better location from that standpoint, as was testified to earlier. Where it's currently proposed, it is beyond the fall zone of any structures or activities on the property or off the property. I would also note that there's a terrain a differential. In terms of where we're proposing the pole on the property versus moving it to the edge of the tree line on the subject property, there's approximately a 10-foot difference in ground elevation. In other words, where we're proposing the pole, it's 10 feet higher than if we were to shift it to the edge of the existing tree line. So again, that's...
You said the pole is 10 feet higher.
I'm sorry, the ground elevation is 10 feet higher. If we were to move it to the edge of the existing tree line, it would require an increase in height of approximately 10 feet to the pole. So for those reasons, I would suggest that the location of the pole as proposed is a better alternative relative to both the visual separation and the fall zone. The applicant's burden of proof here relative to the D3 type variance relief is to show that the site continues to be an appropriate site, notwithstanding the deviation or departure from the conditional use standard. And I believe that is the case. I believe that this is a particularly suited site for several reasons. You heard testimony from the applicant's radio frequency engineer indicating that the site was ideally situated from a technical perspective. It achieves the coverage objective for Verizon Wireless for this particular area of Franklin Township. Secondly, we are proposing this, although in a residential zone where we are conditionally permitted, we are going on a non-residential use. We're going on a piece of property that's a large lot, 810,024 square feet. That translates into 18.6 acres, more than 20 times the minimum lot area requirement in the zone district, which is 40,000 square feet. Fact that there is an extensive wooded area on the subject property, which again helps to mitigate the overall visual impact. At the end of the day, from a planning perspective, wireless telecommunications applications, especially ones that involve new towers, the primary concern and focus from a planning perspective is the visual impact. The fact that the subject property adjoins two township-owned properties that are green acres restricted, heavily wooded, also helps to mitigate issues such as noise and aesthetics. Proximate to major roadways, which are primary generators of wireless telecommunications use, Cedar Grove Lane and New Brunswick Road being the two primary traffic corridors. Proximate to major residential communities. Obviously, there's a number of residential communities in this area, the various Quail Brook communities. The fact that the site affords the opportunity for future co-location, sufficient space, both within the compound area and on the structure to accommodate future co-location, which is a primary objective of your wireless telecommunications ordinance, and last but not least, the fact that we have a willing landlord. So for all of those reasons, I would suggest that the site, which is the subject of the application, is a site that is particularly suited for a wireless telecommunications facility, and that it continues to be an appropriate site, notwithstanding the deviations and departures from the conditional use standards. Would note that as was indicated by the applicant's radio frequency engineer, Verizon Wireless maintains not one but four FCC licenses in four different frequency bands. The courts in New Jersey have found that generally the issuance of an FCC license should suffice for a carrier to establish that the use serves the general welfare. Verizon Wireless maintains four such licenses. In addition to the positive criteria, it is also the applicant's burden to satisfy the negative criteria. The procedure or process established again by the courts in New Jersey for the negative criteria analysis for a wireless telecommunications facility is the seek a balancing test. While the courts in New Jersey have stopped short of declaring these uses inherently beneficial, they have, however, applied the seek a balancing test for the negative criteria analysis. First step being that the board should identify the public interest at stake. I would suggest to the board that the public interest at stake here is significant. The provision of modern state-of-the-art wireless telecommunications
Wait a minute. We already have cell phone coverage here. It's not as if we're going from 0 to 100 miles an hour. They're making an incremental improvement. So I wouldn't agree completely with what you're saying here.
Okay, well, it's obviously it's improvement in coverage for Verizon Wireless. It's Verizon Wireless's network, and it is an improvement in their service. Secondly, the board should identify the detrimental effect that will ensue from the grant of the variance relief. Again, I would note that the primary focus here in terms of detrimental impact is visual detrimental impact is potential visual impact. In that regard, I have prepared photo simulations, which I believe the board has copies of. I have with me here this evening those simulations mounted. There's three boards as well as an aerial photograph. So there's a total of four exhibits.
Let me interrupt for a second. These were submitted to the board subsequent to the application filing. So, Mr. Bradshaw, do you want me to mark these? They're just...
you guys have them?
Blown up version. Okay. You have them already. So.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. No need to mark them individually then.
Nope. Okay. I'd like to start with the aerial photograph, which should be the first image in the set of color copies that you have. This is a Google Earth aerial photograph. And I think the most compelling illustration here on the aerial is the surrounding vegetation around the subject property and the actual proposed location of the installation. And you can actually see the heavily wooded areas along Willow Avenue and New Brunswick Road, which are the township-owned properties that adjoin the subject property. This aerial photograph identifies, in addition to the location of the pole, the vantage points from where the photographs were taken. They were taken from eight vantage points surrounding the subject property with input from your planning department, from your township planner, relative to suggested vantage points. The first view was taken from out on Cedar Grove Lane at number 159. This is essentially across the street from where the driveway entrance to the property exists. And you can see that what we've done here is in each case the first image is the photograph of the balloon. The balloon was a 4-foot diameter red balloon filled with helium. It was flown at a height of 126 feet. And in each case, the A images depict the proposed tree pole, and the B images depict the proposed flagless flagpole.
Rick, why don't you put up the pictures
when
you're addressing them?
So we have 1 through 1B across the top, which is the view from 159 Cedar Grove Lane. Image 2 was taken from the front of the Cedar Hill Prep School. The corresponding tree pole simulation and flagless flagpole simulation. The third view was from Stone Lee Way at Wexford Way, the corresponding simulations of the tree pole and the flagless flagpole. View 4, this was taken between number 15 and number 17 Wexford Way. These are the houses on Wexford Way that are closest to the proposed installation. As you can see, there was no visibility along that particular area of Wexford Way. Number 5 is a view from 293 Abbey Drive with the corresponding simulations of the tree pole and the flagless flagpole. The 6th view was from Smithfield Road at Willow Avenue at the T intersection. Looking across through the vegetation, you can see the balloon in between the wires of the telephone pole, the corresponding simulations to the right. Number 7, view from 17 Monet Court, actually of all the vantage points that we identified this particular location had the greatest visibility in terms of the balloon versus the vegetation that's between the balloon and the vantage point. 7A and 7B, the simulations. The last view from 147 Cedar Grove Lane, again with the proposed simulations in 8A and 8B.
Again, you may have said this, I may have. When were these photos taken?
They were taken on October the 15th of this year. I would suggest to the board that the, while there's obviously visual impact here, and there always is with a new pole, I would suggest that given the particular suitability of this property and the fact that it is surrounded by wooded areas to the south and to the northeast, that while there is visibility from selected vantage points, I would suggest that the detriment here does not rise to the level of substantial detriment. And I believe that the tree pole works well. I wanted to submit an additional exhibit to the board, which they do not, the board does not have. And that is a photograph. Put it on the back.
Tell us what the photograph is.
A4 is a 8.5 by 11 color photograph of the Del Barton tree pole. That's a tree pole that both I and Mr. Stangione were involved in up in Morris Township at the Del Barton School. And again, that is the pole that would be the prototype for this tree pole if the board were to approve it. The elevation that you see in the engineering drawings is simply a an engineering elevation drawing. It is schematic in nature. It's not designed to depict the actual character of the tree pole. I would suggest, and I've seen a lot of tree poles over the last 30 years with my involvement in this work. I believe that's the best example, at least it's the best example that I've seen of a tree pole in
How
New Jersey.
How far away is that, was that picture taken?
That picture was taken from maybe 200 feet away.
200 feet. So, I mean, I'm guessing that that might be roughly, if you're on the swim club site, maybe driving down the driveway or something.
Correct. Maybe halfway down. It's deceiving, though, because you've got vegetation in the foreground. Actually, the closer you get to the site itself, the visibility disappears because the trees that are between you and where the pole is proposed, the angle is such that it blocks off your view.
Okay. Because this site, the monopine is actually going to be far less visible because you have hundreds of feet of forest on many of the other sides.
That's correct.
In fact, probably the place where it's going to be most visible is going to be from the swim club itself.
I would say so, yes.
And that's what I was going to address. And what's the distance, if I can put back up the aerial?
Yeah.
Based on what Mr. Healy was asking, from the nearest adjacent residential streets, approximately, what is the distance?
Well, view one, which was essentially taken on Cedar Grove Lane across the street from the intersection of the swim club's driveway, and these distances were using the Google Earth measuring tool, 1,485 feet to the first vantage point. The second one over at the prep school, 1,540 feet. View number eight, 1,565 feet. The view where there was no visibility between 15 and 17 Wexford Way, 770 feet. Over here on Stoneley Way, looking across the detention basin, 1,100 feet. The closest vantage point was actually number six at Willow Avenue here, 500 and, I'm sorry, 565 feet. Monet Court, which again, because you can see the openness here from the cul-de-sac at Monet Court until you hit the first stand of vegetation, which is on the far side of the detention basin. From that particular vantage point, there was some visibility because, again, the lack of vegetation in the foreground, but that distance is 1,600 feet away.
So based upon your assessment of the visual impact, or lack thereof, what would be the next step in your analysis as to whether this board can grant the variance request?
The third step is that in some situations, the local board may reduce the detrimental effect by imposing reasonable conditions on the use. Certainly a requirement that the tree be camouflaged as some type of alternative structure, such as a tree pole, is a reasonable condition. A requirement for to allow future co-location is a reasonable condition. In terms of the wireless telecommunications ordinance, a requirement to provide some sort of privacy slats or permahedge or some type of inserts in the chain link fence to help conceal the ground equipment is certainly a reasonable condition that the board might impose on the use. Meeting with and working with the Township Fire Prevention Bureau relative to the issue of the driveway width and tree removal, and also in terms of the tree removal, a tree replacement program, again, meeting with the township professionals, are reasonable conditions that the board might impose upon the use to help reduce the detrimental effect. Fourth and final step is that the board should then weigh the positive and the negative criteria, determine whether on balance the grant of the variance relief would cause a substantial detriment to the public good. I would suggest to the board, in considering the positive benefits of wireless telecommunications, coupled with the I believe the appropriateness of this site, given the characteristics of this site, that the level of detriment here does not rise too substantial, and that the positives outweigh the negatives, and as such, satisfy the seeker balancing test, which balances the positive and negative criteria.
I have no further questions of Mr. Masters.
Okay, I just want to make one comment on your first photograph with the aerial view. That was dated September 18th, 2013.
Correct.
Okay. While it's heavily wooded, and it remains fairly heavily wooded, there's a significant portion of those woods that are not there as shown on the picture today, which means it's important, I think, to me that you do hide the shed a little bit.
I'm sorry.
That you do hide the chain link fence a little bit. The privacy fence is fine, except the open space will probably see the, I almost rather see some evergreen plantings there, but I'm not going to say that's strongly enough to try and impose a condition. I think it's a good recommendation, but the woods is just not there the way it was in this picture, because the hurricane knocked down significant numbers of trees.
If when we meet on the site to go over the tree removal and replacement plan, if you at that time felt shrubbery or something around would be appropriate, we can add that.
You can do that on the an agreement with them.
Yes. However, yeah, that we can
so
do.
I just want you to be aware of that. So.
No, and we're certainly willing to add it if there needs to be some landscaping thrown in, and I'm not a botanist, so I can't tell you what type of plants, but whatever is agreed upon would be appropriate.
And Mr. Chairman,
because I'm sure there's some deer back there.
I would suggest that whatever plantings, if there are plantings, that those are just supplemental to whatever opaque fencing is proposed. It's not in placement of.
That's true.
Yes, no, do the fencing too. Yep.
Any other questions for
it? Yeah, this is one question I hadn't asked. How tall is the fence going to be around the compound?
8 feet.
I love that word, 8 foot, okay. All right.
And the equipment is how high?
The equipment's what, five to 6 feet?
With the canopy?
Plus the canopy.
Chad, why don't you answer that, because that would be probably rather... What's the height of the canopy?
Yeah, there's the one thing we didn't discuss is there's also a canopy, just to keep any falling debris, if, you know, should there be ice falling from the pole or rain, fire technicians have to be out there, you know, in inclement weather. There's a canopy that's above the equipment. The top of the canopy is roughly 9 feet above grade, so it's just above height of the fence, technically. The fence is
9 feet. But it's open.
It's open, yeah. It's like just a horizontal plane, so it really would just basically appear as almost an extension of the fence, because it's got the depth of the beam and everything there. So go fence, canopy would just be right there.
Why can't it be lower than the fence?
So the equipment cabinets are 6 feet high. And
yeah.
Cables and cable management that goes above them. So we typically bring the cables up and along above the top of the canopy. So if you put it below the height of the fence, it could be done. It makes it very tight to get cables and other equipment in there.
What happens if you make the fence higher?
That's where we're going.
Well, we could do that too.
We can't lower the water. We're going to raise the bridge.
If that's the desire of the board, we can accommodate either. We're a combination of the two.
That would make sense for two reasons. One, it would hide the canopy, and two, would make life a little more difficult to climb that fence if people were so inclined.
Let's go with the 10-foot fence. Yep. Leave the canopy alone.
Yep.
Because I'm tight.
Any other questions?
I have one for our attorney. Would you agree with the planner as to how we are to evaluate this? Is this a seek a balancing test?
Well, actually, I don't think it is, because it's a D3, and I think all he has to show is that, but for the deviations, it's still an appropriate use. And okay. Then the negative criteria. I think what he went through was probably it's the gold standard. I don't think he actually needed that full proofs, but he gave them to you.
What is that? That better than mediocre? Is that what we're talking about?
Better than mediocre.
You know.
All right.
So the planner's testimony was substantially better than mediocre?
Yeah.
Yeah, like any other questions?
That. Put that on your resume.
We will open to the public for any questions or any statements. No takers?
Public?
Nope. Okay, we'll close the public. Anything else that you would like to say?
No, that concludes our presentation. Again, I think as the board could see, we're trying to incorporate the site we're doing here at the municipal building with this site, which we need a new structure to fill in the gap that we have in our coverage system, and we would hope the board would accommodate and approve this application.
Okay, board comments, questions, discussion, or motion?
I'll see if we can put together a motion, but I'll be happy to listen to amendments for things that I've forgotten. I move that we grant New York SMSA Limited, doing business as Verizon, to erect a cell tower and an equipment compound at property located at 156 Cedar Grove Lane in Somerset, block 424.12, lot 5.01, subject to the following conditions, that the equipment compound be surrounded by a 10-foot wooden fence, and that anything that has to do with fire prevention or with tree removal, tree replacement, or other vegetation changes be worked out between the township departments in charge of those things and the applicant, that the tower be in the form of a what do we call that? A tree?
Monopine is what we call it.
What do
you
call it?
Monopine.
Monopine in the version that is currently erected at the Del Barton School and shown in a photograph to us as A4. Was that correct?
Yes.
A4. Mm-hmm. The entrance to the swim club, that a fence and a gate be erected at the opening to the swim club, subject to the applicant being able to get the agreement of the landlord, and if that's not possible, the applicant can come back and we can discuss that further. I'm sure you'll work that language out. The boughs of the cell tower tree aspect come down as far as the trees in the immediate area, and that's all the things that I can remember.
Did you anything about any vegetation surrounding the fence, subject to working with staff?
I tried to say that. If I didn't, that should be included.
Any other things anyone would like to add?
May I have one comment on the resolution? We would prefer a composite fence rather than wood, only because the wood requires more maintenance.
Composite is what, like decking or something? I'm not so much for the chain link fence idea.
Yeah, the composite's like that, I call it plastic wood.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Plastic wood is fine. I'll amend that.
Plastic wood.
But I don't
plastic
think,
wood,
I don't
earth tone.
I don't think.
Earth tone plastic wood.
I don't think white would be appropriate.
No.
No, we've
earth tone, good.
Did you mention the walkway in the front?
No, I did not. Oh, but I think we can say that, and the applicant will comply with all conditions and requirements in the engineering and other professional reports.
Mm-hmm. Anything else?
And can we have a dark brown trunk in case that's not on the plans already?
Oh, that's the way it comes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I think one of the things too is that you're going to have to provide some documentation in the plans that show, basically depict the Del Barton tree we're talking about with all of these aspects we're talking about. Yeah.
That'll be done in the construction details. But
we'll handle
it.
We'll
deal with it. Don't worry about it. Yeah, we'll figure it out.
Yep. Anything else? Then a second would be helpful.
Second.
Thank you.
All the board.
Ms. Grauman?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Rich?
Yes.
Mr. Shepard?
Yes.
Mr. Rosenthal?
Yes.
Mr. Gallo?
Yes.
Chairman Thomas?
Yes. Good luck with it. Thanks for your cooperation.
Thank you very much.